It is such a privilege to be here. You know, it's actually, I don't like it to bring Josh with because he's more English than me. I'm a real Afrikaans girl and he's English. And always when I speak English and when I come to the States, he says, "Mom, I hope they understand you." So, I always say to him, "Don't worry, Holy Spirit, you know, he's doing everything for me." 14 years back in our lives, our lives changed dramatically. We were all in South Africa, we were all in church. You know, we are good people there, we all go to church. If you're born, they just literally tick on your paper, you're Christian. It's just like that. So we were born in a Christian church and you go to church, but going to church and knowing your father, it's a different story. So I met my husband and we got married and our eldest son's name is Aldo. For 10 years, he was my only child, our only child. And after 10 years, Josh came. And he was really a prayer, both of them. But after 10 years, the doctor said no more. But, you know, God has the final say. Isn't that amazing? So Josh was 2 years old, and our lives was pretty great. And everything, you know, in life, when God created us with a hunger for him. A real hunger for God. And if you don't pursue that hunger and you don't fill your life with God and your whole spirit's not filled with God, you will always try to find something to fill it. So my heart was pretty broken because I came from a house where I had a father who was very hard. He didn't know how to love. So I was always searching. What I was actually searching was for that love. But you know, you don't know how to, so you just search. I worked hard, I tried that, I tried, pursued many avenues. Eventually, I was Mrs. South Africa, and I'll never forget that night. I was in the hotel room, and when they put that crown on, and I entered into the room, I looked at myself, and I spoke to myself, and I said to myself, "So is the hole filled now?" And I looked at myself. And I said, "No." And I did something amazing. And I know that I was prompted by the Spirit. I fell on my face and I took the crown off. And I put it down. And I said, "Father, I want to exchange this for the crown of life." I had no idea what I was saying. But it was my spirit that just thought, "Praise God, she has a moment." And I did it, and I got up, and I was, what did I just say? And 2 months after that, me and my family have been in a very bad car accident. It was a Saturday evening, and driving on the highway in South Africa, our highways don't have lights like this. And it was dark, and there was a car driving in front of us without lights. And the next moment, my husband had to make a choice, and he just turned the vehicle. And I believe if he went straight, I'm pretty sure we've been dead and them. So he tried to avoid the accident, but our vehicle started to roll, and both my children fell out, Josh and Aldo. And after a lot of tumblings, we stopped, and I'll never forget that. I fell out of the car, and I got up, and all these broken pieces, and I fell over them. But there was a soft, gentle spirit, a sound, a voice that spoke to me. And just a couple of days before that, if you would have asked me, "Do you hear God's voice?" I would have said to you, "No, there's a ceiling." But all of a sudden, when the alabaster jar breaks, you can hear God's voice. And believe me today, God don't use accidents to break the alabaster jar. God don't use heartache to do that. He gave his son. His son paid the price. But the moment when I got up there, I heard this voice, and the voice said, "All of the broken pieces in your life is nothing more than a beautiful mosaic of your future." And it was so real in me. And I started searching for my children, and we couldn't find them. And the vehicles stopped, and somebody found Josh in the bush, and he just had a scar, but nobody could find Aldo. And he was 12 at that stage. And I was crying out. You know, it's not like you call your children for dinner. It was from another place. And I cried out, and I said, God, help me find him. And when I cried out, I heard again the voice. And he led me to the other side of the highway. And my husband said to me, that's too far. He will never be there. But I ran. And in the dark, I found him, and his head hit the tar road. And his body was lying on the gravel. And I bent down to speak to him. And when I tried to feel in the darkness, my hand went into his skull. And it felt like I've touched his brain. So deep I went in. And everything in me was dying with him. You know, it's times like that that you don't need a degree to be a doctor. You just know. I tried to feel his pulse and I couldn't get any. And I called my husband and the helicopter came and everybody came. And the paramedic helped him and they just covered him. And then he did a strange thing. He put him on a stretcher and he took a blanket, and it was winter, but he covered him completely with a blanket, even his head. And he called us and he said, Mr. and Mrs. McPherson, you have to come and greet your son. We're not sure if he's going to make the hospital. And what do? So you greet your son. We kissed him. And they covered him again. And they put him into the helicopter. My husband left with him. And me and Josh went to the hospital, and he went in for about 5 hours operation. They took him out in a glass cage like this, and they said to us, you know, we'll give you time with him. Normally all the organs just stop. So every day when we sat there with him, there was nothing. Day by day, you were just sitting there. And day 12, they came to us and said, would you sign these papers, because we're going to donate the organs, and, you know, this is what's going to happen, and tomorrow we're going to put off the machines. And the next day came, and we sat there, and they start putting off the machines, because they did a couple of tests, and there was just no brain function. And, you know, you pray. But you pray to someone that you don't really know. And this is the first time in my life that I realized to know about someone is one thing, but to know someone is a different thing. And I remember I sat there and I said, I don't know you really, God. I don't know you really. And the day when they said they're going to put off the machines, that his heartbeat started going down, down, down. And I was thinking to myself, what parent is looking at this? How do you look at this? My husband still stood there, and I said, I can't watch this. And I ran to the room where I stayed opposite the ICU, and I fell on my face. You know, I didn't cry out to God to save my son, because I knew he's going to die. His heartbeat went down by that stage to 28. So I was like, I fell on my face and I cried out to God for the first time in my life, from spirit to spirit. And that day was supposed to be the worst day in my life, became the best day of my life, because I met the King. And the moment when I cried out to God, I was right there on the floor. But at the next moment, there was a bright light. And no light on earth, not that light, no light on earth can match that light. You see, God is light. And in him, there's no darkness. He just appeared. Because his word says, for those who seek me, they shall find me. But I've never sought God before my life. I always had my own ways. I always had my own answers. And that day, when I entered in his presence, this light was filled with love. God literally stole my whole life with his love. He literally did. In 1 second, until this day, I believe you just need 1 second in God's presence and your whole life will change. That's my belief. 1 second. And that second when I entered in there and his love filled me, I was so dry. I'm telling you, my spirit was so dry, because I was so filled with myself. I was so filled with pride. I was so filled with arrogance. And, you know, God could have looked at me and said, go and get your ducks in a row, but he didn't. He just opened his arms, because this is what his son did. He opened his arms for us and said, come, you can just come. Doesn't matter what you've done in this world. Doesn't matter what is against you. Just come. And your father will pick you up and put you right here. And I cried. And the first thing, I didn't ask him to save my son. I said to him, what am I going to do? I need you. I need you. And this presence was so amazing. And I remember I said to him, I'm not sure where I am now. I'm not sure what's happening to me now, but I'm not going to go back. And I asked him this question. What can I do to have this for the rest of my life? What can I do? And why? I asked this. I said, why should something that bad happen before I entered into your presence? Because believe me, like all of us, we've asked. Lord, I seek your face. Lord, but nothing happens sometimes. You see, because our hearts are so hardened. Our hearts are so full of pain and self and self and self. Centeredness. And he answered me. He said, you couldn't enter in here because you were serving another God. I'm like, no, I'm a Christian. Do you have the right Retah here? And he says, no. He says, you could not enter. You were serving idols. I said, idols? You know, an idol is something that you love more than you love God. For 10 years, Aldo was my own child, my only child. And I used to say these words, I'm so scared something will happen to him. I didn't even let him sleep over. The word of God says, whatever you fear, that will happen to you. That's why the word says, every thought take it captive into obedience to Christ. When fear comes, you have to deal with it. Because that's from Satan out of hell. And I didn't. Aldo was like a God to me. He was my everything. And the words out of my mouth was, he was my everything. You know, your children can be your God. Your money can be your God. Your body can be your God. God says, anything that you love more than you love me is an idol. You cannot come in. You need to lay him down. And I realize I have to lay down my children. And it was so easy to put Aldo down. That was easy. And he said to me, don't you have another one? God, if you can take care of the sick one, you know, I'll take care of the other one. Today, I'm so thankful I gave Josh away. I'm so thankful. I said, Lord, you can take him too. And he said, whatever is precious to you, don't hold on to them. And all of a sudden, I got it. My spirit got it. And I gave my husband away. And I gave our business away. I gave everything away. I felt like we had nothing left. I just gave it. I just gave it. I just gave it. And then, when everything was off me, I could feel how he was saying to me. And he showed me the outer court, the holy place, and the holy of holies. And I'm not going to tell you now. Everything's a long story. You can buy my book on Amazon, A Message from God. And that book, I tell the testimony. And anyway, and he was explaining to me how many people are staying in the outer court and how many people, only few go to the holy place, but few to the holy of holies. Because you have to lay it down. You have to trust God. And in his presence, it was just this moment where he filled me with his love and I could see God for who he is. What did you experience? You can wake me 12 o'clock at night. You can ask me, so what can you tell me about God? I love speaking about the heart of the Father. I just love, I can talk the whole day about that because that's my mission in life, to know more about Him. To know more and more and more about Him. You know, you have so many names. It's like a diamond, so many facets. And we need to explore Him. We need to come closer to His heart. But many of us search His hand and not His heart. You see, we are trying to see what we can get from God. And this is why His word says, seek first the kingdom of God and the right standing with God, and all the rest will follow. Right standing with God is like standing in this place. And, like a Jewish boy would know, the menorah. God once showed me the menorah. And He says, with the seven spirits before the throne, if you just stay in line, in the plumb line, the spirit of wisdom, knowledge, understanding, fear of the Lord, everything will flow through you any time of day. So this is a place. It's called the heart of the Father. So there he just filled me with His love, and I was crying, and He was just holding me. And in the next moment, I saw my son. And I'm like, what is he doing here? And, you know, I'm very sure my soul was saying to my spirit, he's dead, remember? And I'm like, okay, but he's in a good place. I so remember that I was saying, he's in a good place. If this is where he's going to be, hallelujah for dying, being with the Father all the time. And God says, hey, this is the same place where you need to be. You need to die too. You need to die every day, and you can stay here. Because I ask Him, what can I do to stay here? He says, die. Die. Every day. You know, if you put your head down tonight, you need to tell yourself, where did I die today? Where did I die in myself? Because, you see, God is light and self is darkness. So every place where I trade, you see, the trading floor, there's always tradings every day. I trade through the blood. I trade through faith. And every place where Retah die and Christ comes in, more of Christ and less of me. And the light can become more and more and more. So a lot of things that God just downloaded there, a lot of things. And then He said this to me. He says, death or alive, this is not the question. The question is the place in Christ. You see, many times we say, if God can do this for me, if God can just do this for me, if my son is just going to be saved, if this or this or this, then I will. Doesn't matter what we're going through. It's this place. This is where the joy is. This is where the peace is. He says, in this world, you will have difficulties, trials, tribulations. He says, but in me, you will have perfect peace. So this is what we need to seek, in me. So this was foreign for me. This was new for me. This is not what the church taught me. So it was a new journey for me. And then he said to me, your son is not going to die. He's going to live. And I'm like, no, they just said he's going to die. He says he's going to live. And he's going to live to tell the world that Jesus is alive. And my spirit was jumping up and down. I'm saying, yeah. He says, and you will be his mouthpiece. I'm like, okay. He says, and you will walk the walk of faith as a family. You will walk the walk of faith. And he says, faith, my child, is not what you see, but what you hope for. Just bear in mind, those days I didn't know the word of God. So for me, it was God speaking to me. Only later, when I started reading the word and had a hunger for God's word, I'm like, look, this is exactly what he said that day. I kept on running to my husband, look, this is what he said. God is the word of God. Maybe if you wondered, what's God's will is his word, and his word is his will. It's God speaking. So it was powerful for me, and I opened my eyes, and he said to me, you will walk this walk of faith, but step by step, and he will live. So I opened my eyes, I washed my face, and I looked myself in the mirror, and I remember till this day, when I looked myself in the mirror, I knew it's not me anymore. I just knew I was touched. I looked different, and it was a bit scary. I walked back in ICU and the doctor passed, and he was a heart doctor. And I said, what is he doing there? And my husband said to me, he started breathing and living again. He says his heartbeat jumped up to 186. And they're scared if his heart's going to make that. I'm like, what? I said, I know. And everybody was worried about me. They call it ICU syndrome. You know, when you look like that in an ICU, they're worried. I said, it's going to be fine. You know, it's going to be fine. So he starts breathing, and he was fine. But he was blind. He couldn't see, couldn't walk, couldn't talk. He had a trachea, had a tube. He had no bladder control. He had nothing other than breath. So no rehab could take us, because in a rehab you have to help. He couldn't do anything. They've put him in a step down for 3 months. Nothing happened. So one night, me and my husband looked at each other and we just said, time's up, we're going to go. We took him out of hospital. He was straight like this. We took him home like that. And we started exercising him. My husband exercised him, and I started working with him. We invite the therapist to work, to home. They came to home. And one by one, they came in, and they looked at the x-rays. And when they look at the x-rays, they say, no, there's nothing. So one by one, I fired them. So I just said, if they speak death, I said, you know, you can go. So at night, my husband says, well, who's going to do the work? I said, us. So my dress's length went longer because my knees, I took him in, hold his feet, my husband hold him like this, and I took him by the feet and I said, in the name of Jesus, you will walk. In the name of Jesus, you will walk. We took him up and down the corridor and up and down the corridor, and he was looking like this, stiff. Everybody thought we were mad, but we just kept on doing it, kept on doing it. One night, the Spirit of God spoke to my husband. He said, you have to start sealing off the trachea to force him to breathe. He did that at night because I wouldn't have made it. Till about a month or two, he said, he's ready. We can phone the doctor to take this off. We feed him through the tube till one day. I said, no, we have to start doing this. Till time, we just do it by ourselves, by the Holy Spirit. And they kept on looking because he has a severe midbrain injury and a severe front lobe brain injury. So they said he will never walk, he will never talk. And by that time, he didn't speak. So he was in a wheelchair like this. And one day I was speaking on the radio and a woman heard me, a speech therapist. And the doctor, I was speaking about nobody, his mouth was in a spasm then. And later the mouth opened up and we just kept on speaking life. This is one thing the Lord said to me. He's like Lazarus. His spirit can hear every word. Speak to him, he hears every word. Give him words, speak to his spirit man. So she overheard me in the radio and she says, listen, I don't know how, but God said, I need to help you guys. So 3 times a week, we drove into Pretoria, took him there in the wheelchair, and then she started like this. He sits there, can't speak, blind, one eye starts seeing. Till this day, one eye is closed. But he sat there and she said, Aldo, she starts like this, Aldo, I want you to make a little sound. Because a sound become a verb and a verb a word. And he just looked at her, one eye. And I mean, she charges money, so she has to keep on saying it. So she keeps on saying, Aldo, try a little noise. You know, she's doing that for a half an hour, 3 times a week. And about 3-4 months, we were driving in Pretoria, and I was saying, God, if she's going to start all over again today, I'm not sure. I think I'm going to make a noise. You know that feeling? And when we pull her in, I could feel things are moving in here. And when she says, Aldo, I'm like, no. I said, Aldo, stop this great one noise voice stuff. I said, say to this woman, caterpillar. My husband, I knew he's going to do that. So I took my legs already gone. I said, caterpillar. He opens his mouth and he says, caterpillar. I ran to the little toilet and I fell down. I said, God, what happened? Are we nearly in a year? No voice, no noise, no nothing. Caterpillar. God. What happened? He says, faith without works are dead. I was waiting for you. I was waiting for you. Until this day, when God says jump, I jump. Because I know he's going to catch me. Amen. I know he's going to catch me. He starts speaking very slow, very monotone, very loud. 14 years later, still the same. He was blind. And every night you have to put self in and close his eyes. And one night I came back from work and my husband bathed him and put him down and his eyes were still open. And I prayed soft and I did this. And the next thing he did back. And I said, can you see me? And this is after many nights that I was weeping. One night I was weeping and crying. And I went to bed and I sleep. And I, in those years, I thought it was still a dream. I had a dream about Jesus coming into the room. And just, I saw Jesus sitting on the bed. And the next moment, Elder was sleeping next to my bed because he couldn't speak. For years, he was just writing. So he was doing this. The first year, he was doing this. Woke me up, now he wants to write. So he woke me up and he was writing, Jesus in the room. I'm like, no, I had a dream. And he's writing, he says, what I start, I will finish. Trust his timing, Mom. He was still blind. He went to bed and sleep and asked, Lord, look at his faith. Touch him. If you're in the room, touch him. God has a perfect timing for everything. And that's a couple of months later, I walked into the room. And he could see. The first letter that he wrote when the therapist starts coming, she looked the one, she says, you know, there's not much here. But put a pen in his hand and let him just scrabble. I put a pen in and I heard Holy Spirit says, no, you know there's more there than nothing. You know he's perfect fine there. He has a head injury. His spirit's not injured. Do you know that God doesn't use the wiring of your brain to speak to your spirit man? Do you know that? Because he's a fair God. That's why. He's fair. So he bypassed this to speak to this. So if you want to try to figure out God, you're going to miss him. Because God speaks to your spirit. And when she says there's nothing up here, God says, don't even listen to her. I don't need that. I need this. So I put the pen in his hand. He was still spastic. And I could feel the pen is pushing me. And I'm like, okay. And I feel he's pushing me. Now you see, a mom that has faith can see anything. But I thought, whoa, I see an A. I lifted up. I said, okay, we're going to try again. And he pushed my hand up. I'm like, okay. And he keeps on pushing slow, but he pushed. And it was a B. Not bad for somebody that has nothing. And he went on till Z. I'm like, dear Lord. And he starts writing to me. He says, Mom, thank you for surrendering me to Jesus. If you did not, I would have been dead. Remember that night? When I had my encounter with God, and he said, surrender your son. If you didn't surrender, Mom, I would have been dead. He said, you kissed me. Dad kissed me. And Jesus picked me up, and he took me to heaven. I saw Moses. I saw Abram. He told me everything about the golden streets. He starts speaking about the book of Revelation. He's writing to me, Mom, I saw a golden gate. I saw a big bridge. I saw people with gray clothes. They couldn't enter through the bridge. I saw people with black clothes. They couldn't enter either. Only those whose clothes were transparent could enter in. Mom, do you know your clothes are gray? God got my attention very early. You see, God is light. You just need to surrender. His blood washes us so that we can be transparent. Whatever you hold on to life, the darkness that you hold on, the pain that you hold on, you pass on to the next generation. So why would you hold on? That's why Jesus came. He comes for a spotless bride. And all of a sudden, this child of 12, not being able to talk in the beginning, not being even able to talk, was telling me about the book of Revelation, about the times we are in. He says, Mom, we are the Laodicea church. What does he know about the Laodicea church? And the one scripture after the another. And I said to him one day, how do you know all these scriptures? He says, Mommy's breath. I was dying and he was breathing into me. It's his spirit. Well, a long story. I'm going to make it short because of time. So he got better and we exercised him. And then we got a private tutor to take him back to school. We knew he wouldn't be able to do school, but just to bring him back into the system. We got a private tutor into a private school. And just to have there, you know, his own little class. He's just sitting there in the room, but separately. But just let him go back to school. But till this day, I'll just write better than he speaks. He understands everything, but he's with the injury, he can't bring it clearly out. So, but he is writing so amazing, amazing, amazing stuff to us every day, how Holy Spirit downloaded in him. But we struggle with his health and we struggle with his health. But about when he was about 15, one day, he was lying next to my bed still. And he said to me this words. He says, Mom, he was writing. He says, Mom, am I going to get a wife one day? I didn't know what to answer him. At that stage still, till now still, my husband bath him every night, help him. I said, I don't know. We have to ask Abba. He's in control of your life. His will, I don't know. But can you think that night I was crying and weeping? The next day I had to drive far to speak. And on the journey there, it was me and Holy Spirit, and we speak, and I said, Father, I want to ask you something. You heard what he said last night. Is he going to have a wife? I said, Father, is there anyone in this whole world? I didn't say only South Africa. I was covering my base. I said, God, in this whole world, that would love my imperfect child? He says, why do you call him unperfect? I said, God, you know, it's just you and me. You know how difficult it is. He can't walk properly. Today he walks, but you have to hold him. He can't walk on his own, but he walks. You know everything. He says, let me quickly tell you something. To love the unperfect, perfect, is called love. He says, there's no one perfect on this earth. He says, and by the way, I don't see what you see. I don't see what you see. I said, I know. But a wife that will see what you see. And the next moment he says, she's in place. While I was driving, I saw this vision. I pulled off and I was weeping. I was weeping. I said, thank you, Lord. Thank you. And then I'm by myself. I said, but where am I going to find her? Can I close my eyes again? You give me the address? Nothing. I was just worshiping God, praising God, weeping. I got at the place and I got out and speaking. I said, you won't believe what God said, that Alda's going to have a wife and she's going to love him. She's going to honor him. She's going to be there for him. And I could see that. Shame. Oh, shame. Like, what are you doing? I walked out and this woman came up to me and she says, dressed very nice. She says, you know what? My child's not even, I don't know what's the word in English. Josh, help me. But this gebrek. Disabled. She's not even, he isn't even disabled, and he's not even getting a girlfriend. I was like, Satan, get behind me in church. I said, you know, I feel so sorry for your son, because the word of God says, just like you believe, so it will be. Sorry. I walked out, and the Lord just said, take it out. Forgive, forgive, forgive. And I know the power of declaration. I know the power of my words because I've seen it. And I just kept on saying, Father, and every opportunity I had, I just gave the word. I said, this is what God said. This is how it will be. So one day, I went back and I said, oh, you won't believe. God said, yeah. He said, yeah, and she's beautiful. And I said to God, but where am I going to find her? Can we speak again? Where am I going to find her? He says, easy. I already showed you. I said, I know, but I need her here. He says, yes, bring kingdom to earth every day of your life. Bring kingdom to earth. I said, but nobody teach me how. How? He says, open it up. Bring it down every day. The words that you speak, call the things that are not as though they are. Call the things that are not as though they are. So every night he was lying there next to me. I said, Aldo, we prayed. And after this, I said, this is what God says. She's beautiful. Look, she's coming. I made a movie. Yeah, she's coming. Oh, she's gorgeous. She loves you. Look at her. Wow. Look at her. She's going to love you and be there for you. She's going to be your soulmate. And she loves God. And he was just listening to me and turning around asleep. And about 70, he one day asked me, didn't he show you the honeymoon? I was so happy. You know the hormones? It needs to be in place. So the journey went, and I ministered in 7 years, by the way. I called her. 7 years. You know how many nights I've put the light on and Satan laughs at me? You know that? People laugh in your face. People hate faith journeys. They feel uncomfortable with that. Where you trust God. They feel so uncomfortable, they don't know what to do with you. Anyway, so 7 years. And people will say to me, how many years already? So one day I was ministering in Indonesia and we had a miracle crusade. I came back and I was so filled with the Spirit. I'm telling you, I was just weeping, crying. And I was ministering that night in a really religion church. So there, I was looking at it, and I'm like, there's no space for the people even to come out for an altar call. What are we going to do? And I'm like, just thinking, speaking to God. And the next moment, I was just weeping. I couldn't start ministering. The Spirit was so upon us. And the next thing, I see the people falling out their chairs. I'm like, whoa-wee. And the pastor, he was a reverend, sitting there, and I could see he's looking at me. I'm like, not me. It's not me. Look at me. And people are just falling out of the chairs. And I could see, whoa, okay, God is moving. God is moving. And God said to me, I don't want you to do anything. I'm busy moving. You just stand. Worshiping God on my knees, and everybody was on their knees. And it was late night, and we already by then was hijacked twice. So I said to the reverend, I need to go because I still have an hour's drive home. I'm going to leave now because it's getting dangerous. I said, but you take over. And I just left out to the church, and a young girl ran up to me, and she tapped me like this. She says, I don't know what happened tonight. The fire of God came upon me, and he said, I'm your son's wife. I said, you what? I said, so you better get in the Spirit. And I got in my car. I'm like, what did I just do? Where am I going to find her now? I got home. I said to my husband, this is what happened. The next morning, Aldo got up and he wrote. He says, Holy Spirit showed me, he showed you my wife. I'm like, dear God. I said, I know. God spoke to her, said to her, for 1 year, get yourself ready. Get yourself ready. So after a year, I didn't know that. After another year, that was year 7, we had in my office a retreat because God had to teach me how to serve. You see, God wants his character in you. And pride, it's not part of him. That's Satan's character. And if you can't serve, you haven't trained that yet. So God let me people come to my office for 2 days. I was feeding them everything, baptized them, and praying for them, speaking in tongues. And then the last day, Aldo was washed their feet in the prayer room. So I sat there, and the next thing I heard him said, I was praying like this, I heard him said, thank you for waiting for me. I'm like, who's this? And it's like God lift the veil, and there she is. It was like this happening. In the journey, He was very sick, fighting for his life. I just want you to see the video, and then we quickly go on. How much time do I have left? 15. Okay, quickly the video.
The news came to Jesus. Please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus. He did not come. They wondered why. The death watch was over.
We have a faithful God, but I want to tell you, after everything, they married 4 years. Although got very sick again, and December, January, he fell back into a coma. We nearly lost him. The doctors had no hope for him. And I was confronted again, once again. Will you love me? Doesn't matter what. Will you still do what I've asked you to do? Doesn't matter what. Will you honor me? Doesn't matter what. Do you love me for what I do for you? You see, loving God is the richest riches that you can have in life. I know many people who have a lot of money. But if you don't have God, you are one of the poorest people I know. We have the privilege to minister in Africa, in Uganda, Rwanda, and Burundi, those countries. I've stayed in little shacks. I've seen how maize meal for a whole week we eat and the maize didn't go down. I've seen enough of God to know He can do anything. But knowing God and being one with God is much more than anything the world can offer you. I want to ask you today, do you know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Do you know Him as your Messiah, your Lord and your Savior, as your best friend? Do you live in His heart? Is He your everything? Or do you just want Him to heal or to do this or to do this? If God can give me a new job, if God can do this, then I will seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness and all the rest. I'm telling you, that rest is to have peace and joy in the midst of everything. In the midst of everything. It is the greatest blessing. What we've been through, December and January, was exactly what we've been through 14 years ago. And the way we've handled it was completely different. Completely different. Yes, it's tough. It's tough. But having God, it's all I want in my life. Because He's more than anything. He's more than enough. I want to make an altar call today. And I want to ask you, Jared, would you come? I don't want you to walk out here today not knowing that your whole life belongs to Him. Walk out here without surrendering your children to Him. Walk out here without surrendering your everything to Him. You know, many people say they know me, but they don't know me till they've shared a room with me. So Audrey's sharing a room this week with me. And this is one thing that I've learned in this journey. You only have today. You only have today. You don't know what tomorrow brings. So I squeeze it out 12 o'clock. Only after 12 I want to go to bed. I want to make sure I've squeezed out everything. You only have today. You don't know if you're going to have tomorrow a chance. Make the right choice. The King loves you and thank you.